فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
The second type of people when it comes to this principle are من لا إخلاص له ولا متابعة. A people who have no sincerity and they are not in accordance to the sunnah. فليس عملهم وافقا للشرع. Their actions are not in accordance to the sharia. وليس هو خالصا للمعبود. And it is also not sincerely done for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's sake. It is like those people who beautify their actions and they beautify their righteous deeds or their doings. They beautify it for the people. And it is not even in accordance to the sunnah. ولذلك الله said in the ayah, لا تحسبن الذين يفرحون بما أتوا ويحبون أن يحمدوا بما لم يفعلوا فلا تحسبنهم بمفازة من العذاب ولهم عذاب أليم. In this ayah, Allah تبارك وتعالى, He says that they are happy with what? بما أتوا, that which they have been given. The innovation that they have, that they are in. The misguidance and the shirk which they are in, they're happy with it. وَيُحِبُّونَ, but what they want to be is أَيُّحْمَدُ, they want to be praised for following the sunnah and being sincere. That's what they want to be praised for. When in reality what they are doing is what? They are doing shirk and they are doing bid'ah. That's what they want to be praised for. They want to be praised for the sunnah and they want to be praised for the ikhlas and the sincerity. When they're not upon that. القسم الثالث, the third type of people are who? من هو مخلص, a person who is sincere في أعماله, in his actions, لكنها على غير متابعة الأمر, but he is not in accordance to the sunnah. كالجهال العباد, and this is the majority of the worshippers, the ignorant worshippers, والمنتسبين إلى طريقة الزهد والفقر, those people who want to be aesthetic, who fall into tasawwuf and stuff like that. A lot of them are sincere in what they are doing. And they do it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But reality is that they are what? Are they doing in accordance to the sunnah? Are they doing in accordance to the sunnah? No, they are not. So a pillar is missing from their religion. The religion stands on these two pillars, ikhlas wa mutaba'at al-rasul, sincerity and in accordance to the sunnah. So will the action be accepted from them? The action won't be accepted from them. And the presence of one does not eliminate the other. The presence of one does not eliminate the other one. What does that mean? Just because a person has sincerity and ikhlas, it doesn't mean in any way, form or shape that we say that, and they don't have mutaba'at al-rasul, they are not in accordance to the sunnah. We won't say, ya akhi, look, I know he's praying fajr 4 rak'ah, I know. And I know there's no delil for that. But look at him, he's crying, ya akhi. Ya akhi, the man is sincere, man. Ya akhi, the man is doing for the sake of Allah. Akhi, look at his intention. The intention is praiseworthy. And it's noble that he has that. But the presence of sincerity does not get rid of what? It doesn't get rid of what? It doesn't get rid of the other pillar that is missing, which is that who sanctioned and who permitted for him to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with what? Fajr 4 rak'ah. Who gave that permission to him? Are you with me, brothers? That's very important. Because the people try to come to the sincerity side and try to blackmail you on the sincerity. That presence doesn't eliminate. And the same is a person who's accordance to the sunnah, who has no sincerity in his actions. He's no sincerity, and he's following the sunnah from the apparent. He's got a miswak in his pocket. He's got a beard, mashallah. His thobe is above his ankles. Or his trousers above his ankles. And he's what? La ikhlas lahu. No sincerity. Another illness. All of those are not praiseworthy. So just because he's following the sunnah, he's going to be criticized for not following that. For not having sincerity. Al-Qismu al-Rabi'u, the fourth type. The fourth one is من أعماله على متابعة الأمر لكنها لغير الله. He's in accordance to the sunnah, but he's not done for the sake of Allah. He prays Fajr in the masjid, but he does that so that people can say, look at him, Allahu Akbar. He fasts Mondays and Thursdays. He reads the Quran. All of the things that he does is in accordance to the sunnah. It is what the Prophet came with. It is sanctioned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it's legislated by him. But his intention, his motive behind these actions are other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are the four types of people when it comes to these pillars. And the ones who we should be working towards. And the one that we need to be is the first type of people. Which is the ones who combine between sincerity and what? And mutaba'at al-rasool. To be in accordance to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. القاعدة الثانية. The second قاعدة and the second principle is مصدر التشريع والدعوة والعبادة هو القرآن والسنة الصحيحة. Pay attention. The source of legislation, مصدر التشريع. The source of so the second principle now, we're going to the second principle. The source of legislation. Where do you take your legislation from? Where do you take your da'wah from? Where do you take your ibadat from? هو القرآن والسنة الصحيحة. So source of legislation and da'wah and ibadah, all of them are taken from where? They are taken from the Qur'an. And it is taken from the sunnah to sahiha, the authentic sunnah. It is taken from the authentic sunnah. That's the second qa'idah. The evidence for this qa'idah is Allah says in Surah Al-A'raf, ayah 3. Allah says in Surah Al-A'raf, ayah 3. Allah says, ittabi'u follow. Ittabi'u follow. Ma unzila ilaykum min rabbikum. That which has been sent to you from your Lord. وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا and do not follow. مِن دُونِهِ أَوْلِيَاء. Besides Allah, don't follow allies. وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا and don't follow. مِن دُونِهِ besides Allah, أَوْلِيَاء, allies. Righteous people, don't follow them. This ayah tells us to follow what? The revelation. The wahi, the kitab and the sunnah. مَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكُم مِّن رَبِّكُمْ. That which has been sent from Allah. The Qur'an has been sent from Allah and the sunnah has been sent from Allah. Both of them are sent from Allah. As the poet said, Hafidh al-Hakami, what did he say? فَسُنَّةُ النَّبِيُّ وَحْيٌ ثَانٍ عَلَيْهِمَا قَدْ أُطْلِقَ الْوَحْيَانِ وَإِنَّمَا طَرِيقُهَا الرِّوَايَةِ فَافْتَقَرَ الرَّاوِي إِلَى الدِّرَايَةِ. The sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ is what? Is a second revelation. Second revelation. So we need to follow it. Both of them are from Allah. The Qur'an is from who? Is from Allah. And the sunnah is from Allah. So both of them, follow them. And don't follow anyone besides that. Don't follow an individual. The second ayah, Allah says, وَأَطِيعُ اللَّهَ obey Allah. وَالرَّسُولَ and obey the messenger. Brothers and sisters, I want you to understand something. When the companion said to the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, إِذَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ whatever Allah wills. وَشِئْتَ and you wish Muhammad. What did the Prophet ﷺ say to them? أَجْعَلْتَ لِي لِلَّهِ نِدًّا. Have you made me equal to Allah? Did he not say that? They said, مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ whatever Allah wills. وَشِئْتَ and whatever you will Muhammad. What did the Prophet say to them? أَجْعَلْتَنِي what? أَجْعَلْتَ لِي لِلَّهِ نِدًّا. Have you made me equal to Allah? Did he not say that? Are you with me, brothers? Why did he say that? Because they used a letter in that sentence of theirs, which was waw. And the waw shows atf, connection. That the will of Allah and the will of the Prophet are both connected. Are you with me? And the Prophet disagreed with that. And he rejected that statement. And what did he say? قُلْ say, مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ ثُمَّ شَاءَ مُحَمَّدٍ. Why did he say, use the word ثُمَّ? Because the word thumma shows tartib and ta'qib. It shows that the will of Allah comes first, and then whose will comes after? Whose will comes after? The messenger. But when it comes to the obedience of Allah and His messenger, Allah and the messenger, the waw is always used. The waw is used. Thumma is not used. You know why the waw is used? Huh? The reason why the waw is used is because the obedience of Allah and the messenger are the same. That's why Allah said in this ayah, wa ati'u Allah, obey Allah, wa rasul, and obey the messenger. لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ You will attain from it Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy. What are you going to attain? Yeah? You're going to attain Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy. وَقَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى Allah also says, فَاسْتَمْسِكْ بِالَّذِي أُوْحِيَ إِلَيْكَ إِنَّكَ عَلَى صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ فَاسْتَمْسِكْ This ayah is in Surah Zukhruf. Ayah 43. And the previous verse was in Surah Al Imran, ayah 132. فَاسْتَمْسِكْ Hold on to. بِالَّذِي أُوحِيَ إِلَيْكَ The revelation that was sent on you. إِنَّكَ You are verily then upon. عَلَى صِرَاطِ مُسْتَقِيمَ You are on the straight path. You are on the straight path. Hold on to the revelation. Then you are upon the straight path. So if you want to know a person who's on the straight path, what are they holding on to? Huh? They are holding on to the revelation. Allah also says in Surah Al-Hujurat, the first ayah, Ya أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا Those of you who believe, لَا تُقَدِّمُوا بَيْنَ يَدَيِ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ Don't go before Allah and His Messenger. Don't say anything before Allah and His Messenger. Don't do anything before Allah and His Messenger. Wait for Allah's Messenger's rules and their regulations and that which they sanction. Once you know what that is, then follow that. Don't speak before it. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is in Surah Al-Hujurat, ayah 1. This Allah also says in Surah Al-Isra, ayah 36, وَلَا تَقْفُ مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ إِنَّ السَّمْعَ وَالْبَصَرَ وَالْفُؤَادَ كُلُّ أُولَٰئِكَ كَانَ عَنْهُ مَسْئُولًا Allah says, وَلَا تَقْفُ مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِعِلْمٍ That a person should not talk about that which they don't have no knowledge of. What is it that the knowledge that you don't have? The knowledge that you don't have is a knowledge that you don't understand what? You don't have no textual evidence for it. You don't have قَالَ Allah and you don't have قَالَ الرَّسُولِ in this particular matter. So you don't want to speak before the evidence comes to you. So Allah says, وَلَا تَقْفُ مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ الْعِلْمِ Don't speak about what you have no knowledge of. إِنَّ السَّمْعَ Hearing. وَالْبَصَرَ And seeing. وَالْفُؤَادَ And the heart. كُلُّ أُولَئِكَ كَانَ عَنْهُ مَسْئُولًا You'll be questioned for those all the day of judgment. Your hearing, your seeing, and your heart. Everything you'll be asked the day of judgment regarding it. Also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, وَالنَّجْمِ إِذَا هَوَى وَالنَّجْمِ إِذَا هَوَى مَا ضَلَّ صَاحِبُكُمْ وَمَا غَوَى وَمَا يَنطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى Allah says to us in here, وَمَا يَنطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى Nabiullah Muhammad, does he speak from his whims and desires? Allah said he does not speak from his own whims and desires. So whatever the Prophet says is from who? It's from who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's a revelation. It's a revelation. Also the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, in a hadith al-Imam Hakim narrated in his Mustadrak, this hadith is Hassan. Al-Imam Malik also narrated in his Muwatta, but he narrated in his Muwatta balaghan. Balaghan means, it means that Imam Malik would say, balaghani, it reached me that the Prophet said this. Are you with me? That the Prophet what? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said this. And it's basically Imam Malik narrating a hadith without a chain of narration. He's narrating a hadith without a chain of narration. It's like what you would say in Sahih al-Bukhari, mu'allaq, right? This hadith is mu'allaq. Muwatta, you say balagh. You say it's what? It's a balagh. He narrated a balaghan. And the hadith has many narrations to authenticate it. وَلَهُ شَوَاهِدٌ It's also narrated from Jabir radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Sheikh Nasir authenticated it. Sheikh Muhammad Nasir al-Din al-Albani, rahimahullah, he authenticated this. And this hadith is, تَرَكْتُ فِيكُمْ شَيْئَيْنِ I have left two things for you. لَن تَضِلُّوا بَعْدَهُمَا You will never be misguided after these two things. I have left two things for you. and you will never be misguided. You will never be misguided after them. Kitab Allah, the book of Allah, was sunnati and my sunnah. I have left two things for you. If you hold on to these two things, you will never be misguided. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? Basically, we today have the thing that's going to give us salvation. We hold on to these two, we're not going to be misguided. Kitab Allah, the book of Allah, was sunnati, and the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And somebody will come up to you today and they will say to you, and this is wallahi ya ikhwah, is dangerous. It's extremely dangerous for somebody to come and to say to you, saying, I'm going to hold the success of the people is connected to the Kitab and the Sunnah. This is a cliche. You hear people say that today. When in reality, it is what the Prophet told us, alayhi salatu wasalam, that these are the two things I have left for you, in which if you hold on to, you're going to find success. So this is what this point was, right? Are you with me, brothers? This qa'idah that we took right now was what? That every single thing, where do you take your da'wah from? Where do you take your ibadah from? Where do you take your ibadah from? The Qur'an and the sunnah, the authentic sunnah, right? So you take the salah from where? Qur'an and sunnah, right? What about your da'wah? The way you give da'wah, where do you take that from? Where do you take it from, brothers? Which one did the Prophet do more? Did he do more salah or did he do more da'wah in his life? The Prophet's da'wah was longer than his salah. The da'wah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was longer in period, was far longer than his salah alayhi salatu wasalam. And he alayhi salatu wasalam sanctioned how to pray, what you can do in the prayer, what you can't do in the prayer, what will nullify your prayer, what is needed in your prayer, what's the prerequisite for the prayer, what is the pillar for the prayer, everything he clarified it. Is it not the case? When in reality, the prayer of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam came when? When did the salah come? After 10 years of his ibadah, after 10 years of da'wah. Sah? And his da'wah never stopped alayhi salatu wasalam. His da'wah still carried on in Medina. Are you with me, brothers? So the same way that the salah can't be done except for you, the kitab and the sunnah, you can't do da'wah unless it's found in what you're saying, what you're calling to, how you're going to call to it. Has to be sanctioned by the kitab and the sunnah. Don't make your own way for da'wah. So this is what this qa'idah is, that the source in which your religion is taken from, your da'wah is taken from, your ibadah is taken from, is the Qur'an and the sunnah. وَلِذَلِكَ الْإِمَامُ أَحْمَدْ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهِ He said, عَجِبْتُ لِقَوْمٍ I am amazed with a people. عَرَفُ الْإِسْنَادَ They came to know the chain of narration, meaning they know the ahadiths. وَصِحَتَهُ They know the authenticity of these hadiths. I'm amazed, Imam Ahmed said, at a people who know the hadiths. They even know they've memorized the hadith. They know its chain of narration. They know its authenticity. They're aware of it. فَذَا يَذْهَبُونَ إِلَىٰ رَأْيِ سُفْيَانِ And then they go, leave the hadith, and they go towards the opinions of who? Sufyan al-Thawri. They have an ayah here, they have a hadith here. They leave those, and they go to the opinion of Sufyan al-Thawri. Sufyan is an imam. وَاللَّهُ تَعَالَى يَقُولُ أَنَّ اللَّهِ سَيْنِ إِنَّ الْقُرْآنِ فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ أَن تُصِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةً أَوْ يُصِيبَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ Be cautious and warned. الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ Those who are opposing Allah's commands. أَن تُصِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةً That a trial and a tribulation will fall them. أَوْ يُصِيبَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ Or that they are going to encounter a severe punishment the day of judgment. Sufyan al-Thawri was calling them to a mas'ala aqadiyya that an ayah was going against, or a mas'ala fiqhiyya? Mas'ala fiqhiyya. Sufyan al-Thawri is an imam in aqidah. He wasn't saying anything that was going against the aqidah. So then Ahmed, rahimahullah, is saying a fiqh issue. That they see that Sufyan's opinion And there's an ayah and a hadith in this mas'ala. It's a fiqh issue. They are going and they're doing what? They're leaving the ayat and the Quran. And they're taking the opinion of Sufyan al-Thawri. And a mas'ala is mas'ala fiqhiyya aslan. Fi furu' al-masail. It's the sub-branches of the religion. It's not even fundamental issues. But Imam Ahmed is upset with this. You have an ayah in this matter, even if it's a sub-branch. How then, what do you then think? People are going against the Kitab and the Sunnah in matters which are usul, fundamentals. Da'wah falls under the fundamental issues of the religion. Da'wah is mas'ala manhajiyya, is min usul al-deen. It's not min furu' al-deen. And even if it is from the furu' of the religion, who said to you every furu' you can make your way for it, or you can do how you want? Are you with me, brothers? And here we have Ahmed rahimahullah being upset in a far'i matter. Is that it? La, Ibn Abbas, look what he said. He said, "Yushiku, you guys are very close. And tunazzal alaykum, that is sent upon you, hijarata min as-sama. Rocks are going to be thrown at you from the sama. Aqulu, I am saying to you, qala Allahu, Allah said. I am saying to you, qala rasuluh, the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. Wa taquluna, and you guys are coming and saying to me, qala Abu Bakr wa Umar. Abu Bakr and Umar said. Brothers, who is Abu Bakr and Umar? Who are they? They were people we were told to follow. عليكم بسنتي وسنة الخلفاء الراشدين المهديين من بعدي عضوا عليها بالنواجد. We were specifically commanded to follow Abu Bakr. We were specifically commanded to follow Umar in this hadith of the Prophet. صح؟ But even then, if Abu Bakr and Umar go against an ayah in the Quran or a hadith in, of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, Abdullah ibn Abbas did not accept their opinion. And he didn't let the people accept that opinion. And this mas'ala was a what? هي مسألة فقهية. It's a fiqh related matter. It was مسألة التمتع بالعمرة والحج. It's a مسألة of التمتع. And Abdullah ibn Abbas had an ayah from the Quran which is what? فمن تمتع بالعمرة إلى الحج فما استيسر من الهدي. He has an ayah from the Quran. Ayah which is محكمة. He had a crystal clear verse in front of him. He also has the Prophet's actions. Meaning, we did تمتع in حجة الوداع. When the Prophet was in front of us, the Prophet didn't do tamattu. But some of the companions did tamattu. The Prophet told them to change their intention and to do tamattu. Not only that, the Prophet ﷺ said, لو استدبرت من أمري ما استقبلت. If I was to go back in time and I was to get the opportunity again, I would have done tamattu. The Prophet said that. Abdullah ibn Abbas has all those evidence in front of him. He has the opinion of his own father, his dad, Umar. Abdullah ibn Umar also said the same, by the way. Abdullah ibn Abbas is saying it here. Ibn Umar was the same. They came to him and they asked him, and they said, but your father said. He said, my father, his opinion is not accepted. I have qala Allah and qala al-Rasul. Same issue, mas'alatu tamattu. Abdullah ibn Umar, he said, my father, Umar, his opinion is not going to be taken. Why? Because I have the opinion of, I have the adilla from the Quran and the Sunnah. The Sahabas didn't come to Abdullah ibn Abbas and they didn't say to him, who are you to oppose these great mountains? Sah? Did they say that to him? How old was Abdullah ibn Abbas when the Prophet died? 13? 14? 15. The biggest call is that he's 15. But because he had the evidence with him, everyone went quiet and they left him. They are the two most noble people on the face of this earth after the prophets of Allah. Abu Bakr and Umar, right? Ma'adalik, when they went against the evidence and they opposed it, Abdullah ibn Abbas, he stuck to the qa'idah, which is what? The qa'idah which was what? Masdar al-tashri' wal-da'wat wal-ibadah is from where? Huwa al-Qur'an wa-sunnah al-sahiha. It's from the Qur'an and it's from the authentic sunnah. Are you with me, brothers? So when we come across a matter like this, we should not sway. Of however big that person may be, the matter is, where does the evidence lie? That qa'id is very powerful. Wallahi, my beloved brothers and sisters, if you traveled to China for this qa'idah, and you came back, just this qa'idah, you went to China, nothing else, just this, and you came back and you learned this principle alone, Ya Ikhwa, this journey of yours would be worthwhile. It would be a journey that was worthwhile. You traveled for something very honorable, صراحةً. The third قاعدة. القاعدة الثالثة. The third قاعدة. أن أهل السنة والجماعة أهل السنة والجماعة لا يستقلون بفهم القرآن عن السنة. Pay attention. أهل السنة والجماعة. هو أهل السنة والجماعة. They are a people who are holding on to the Sunnah. From the name, what does it say? أهلُ Sunnah. They are the people of the Sunnah. They befriended the Sunnah. They live by the Sunnah. وَالْجَمَاعَةَ And they are united upon the Sunnah. They are not united upon ideologies. They are not united upon man-made laws and constitutions. What united them is the Sunnah. You see that they are of different ethnicities. They are of different backgrounds. They have a different, you know, upbringing. But all of them, what united them? What brought them together? The Sunnah united them. What united them? The Sunnah. But they are Ahlul Sunnah. Ya Ikhwa, you can't unite with somebody if there's nothing that's going to unite you. Can you? If we say, okay, everybody use your logic. I use my logic, you use your 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 logic. We all tell everybody to use their logic. Hey, whose logic is going to bring us together? Does that make sense? We won't agree. Because I think in a particular way. You, on the other hand, think in another way. I think what I'm saying is right. You think what you're saying is right. Our way of thinking is different. There has to be something that brings us together. And the thing that can bring us together is a divine law. It's a shara' from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why Ahlul Bid'ah are always called what? Ahlul Bid'ah wal Furqati. You know why? Innovation brings disunity. Furqa comes from Bid'ah. Abu Mudhafar al-Sam'ani rahimahullah has a book called Intisar Ahlil Hadith. He mentions that if you travel the earth and you go around the earth, and you meet a person of the Sunnah, wherever they are, they all speak the same. You meet one here in Africa, you meet one in China, you meet one in India, you meet one in Europe, you meet one in America, you meet one in Brazil, Iceland, the Antarctic, wherever you go, he's freezing, he'll still tell you the Sunnah the way it is. He's in the cold, in the I know Iceland, Iceland's not cold, is it? It's normal, right? But the Antarctic is cold, right? Yeah? Huh? It is, right? He's there. قال الله قال الرسول. He's giving the evidence the way it is. Wherever you go, the Chinese one, he'll tell you in his language. They've never met each other. But what's bringing them together? Why are they all speaking the same? Why are they all united from their speech? The reason why they're united is because أخذوا من منبع صافي. They took from a pure source. Are you with me, brothers? So أهل السنة والجماعة لا يستقلون أهل السنة. They don't understand the Quran independent from the Sunnah. أن أهل السنة والجماعة that أهل السنة والجماعة لا يستقلون بفهم القرآن عن السنة. They don't understand the Quran independent from the Sunnah. Are you with me? In other words, their understanding of the Quran is cupped with the understanding of what? The Sunnah. They use the Sunnah to understand the Quran. They use the Sunnah to understand the Quran. Because Allah tabarak wa ta'ala commanded them, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, those of you who believe, Ati'u Allah, obey Allah. وَأَطِيعُوا الرَّسُولَ and obey the messenger. وَأُولُو الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ and obey those who have authority over you. فَإِن تَنَازَعْتُمْ if you dispute one another. فِي شَيْءٍ in any matter. فِي شَيْءٍ فَإِن شَرْطِيَ right? شَرْط فِي سِيَاقِ النَّهِي شَرْط is what we call نَكِرَةٌ فِي سِيَاقِ الشَّرْطِ تُفِيدُ الْعُمُمْ right? فَإِن تَنَازَعْتُمْ if you differ, if you differ in a matter. Here it says fi shay'in in means any matter, any matter, any matter. What do you do? فَرُدُّهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ bring it back to Allah and His Messenger. So what do they bring it back to? They bring it to Allah and messenger. They don't just bring it to the Quran. This is where the munkiri as-sunnah are refuted. The people who reject the Quran as-sunnah. And they say, we don't believe the sunnah. So what about Allah's statement here? فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ He'll say to you, but this ayah was talking about when the Prophet was alive. Hey, why have you restricted it to that meaning? Because the Quran, is it going to be implemented till the Day of Judgment? He'll say to you, yes. The Quran will be implemented until the Day of Judgment. And so this part, you're saying that this part is not, we're not going to no longer implement it? Is that what you're saying? وَالرَّسُولِ Because the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we take it back to his sunnah now. We still take it back to him. Are you with me, brothers? Also Allah says, وَأَنْزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ Nabiullahi Muhammad, Allah says to the Prophet, وَأَنْزَلْنَا We sent down. What did we send down? إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ We sent down the Qur'an on you. لِتُبَيِّنَ Why did we send the Qur'an on you? لِتُبَيِّنَ To clarify the Qur'an. The reason we send down the Qur'an on you, Muhammad, is to clarify it for the people. مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ Surah An-Nahl, Ayah 44. The previous one I read was in Surah An-Nisa, Ayah 59. Also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah An-Nur, Ayah 63, Allah says, فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِي Be cautious of those who are opposing His command. Meaning, whose command? The Messenger. عَنْ أَمْرِهِ أَيْ أَمْرُ النَّبِي صلى الله عليه وسلم أَنْ تُصِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةً That they will be afflicted with a trial and tribulation. أَوْ يُصِيبَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ Or that they will be afflicted the Day of Judgment with a severe punishment. The Messenger said in a hadith, Al-Imam Ahmad, Abu Dawood and Tirmidhi, they narrated it. And Sheikh Muhammad Nasiruddin al-Albani authenticated it in his Sahih Abi Dawood. Hadith 1294. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Ala inni utitul Qur'an wa mithlahu ma'ah. The Prophet said, O people, I have been given the Qur'an and the likes of the Qur'an, I have been given it. Ala yushiku rajulun shab'anun ala arikati. A man who is full stomach. He's full. And he's leaning on his what? Arika. He's leaning on a pillow or whatever. He's leaning sideways. Yaqulu, this person will come. And he will say to عليكم بهذا القرآن Upon you is the Qur'an فما وجدتم فيه من حلال فأحلوه وما وجدتم فيه من حرام فحرموه He will say anything you find in the Qur'an make it halal Whatever the Qur'an makes halal make it halal Whatever the Qur'an makes it haram make it haram That's what he will say In other words all he wants to take is the what? The Qur'an The Prophet said people I have come with the likes of the Qur'an So he already told us they're going to come and people are going to reject the sunnah. We're only going to say that we want to take the Qur'an. Irbad ibn Sariyah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, وَعَذَنَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ مَوْعِظَةٍ بَلِيغَةٍ The Prophet advised us. The Prophet advised us an advice that was very strong. وَجِلَتْ مِنْهَا الْقُلُوبِ The hearts, they moved from it. وَضَرَفَتْ مِنْهَا الْعُيُونَ And the eyes started to water, the Sahaba started to cry from the reminder that the Prophet was giving them. Their hearts started to move. فَقُلْتُ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ I said, O Messenger of Allah, كَأَنَّهَا مَوْعِظَةٌ مُوَدَّعٍ فَأُوصِنَا It's like it's a farewell advice that you're giving us. O Messenger of Allah, advise us. Then the Messenger said, أُوصِيكُمْ بِتَقْوَى اللَّهِ I advise you to be conscious of Allah. وَالسَّمْعِ وَالطَّاعَةِ And to listen and to obey your leaders. وَإِنْ تَأَمَّرَ عَلَيْكُمْ عَبْدٌ حَبَشِي Even if the person who's placed in charge of you is an Abyssinian slave. He's a slave. The Arabs wouldn't allow that. But even if he is. وَإِنَّهُ مَنْ يَعِشْ مِنْكُمْ Then the Prophet said, "From whoever from amongst you lives, فَسَيَرَ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا He's going to see a lot of disputes. Pay attention. Are we seeing that today? Are we seeing a lot of disputes? Brothers and sisters, I'm asking a question. Are we seeing a lot of disputes? As the Prophet told us, we go to a masjid, this masjid is called Masjid Fulan. We go to this masjid, they believe this. You go to this masjid, they believe this. You go to this place, they believe this. Everyone believes something. Everyone is saying what they're upon is upon the haqq. Sah? The Prophet told us this. You know, مَنْ يَعِشْ مِنْكُمْ Whoever from amongst you lives, فَسَيَرَى اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. He's going to see a lot of disputes and a lot of differences. And so what should we do, O Rasulullah? When this happens, فَعَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي. Upon you is my sunnah. وَسُنَّةِ الْخُلَفَاءِ الرَّاشِدِينَ الْمَهْدِيِّينَ. And the sunnah of my rightly guided khulafa. عَضُّوا عَلَيْهَا بِالنَّوَاجِدِ. Hold on to that sunnah with your molar teeth, your back teeth. If you put, if something goes into your molar teeth, and you hold on to it, would you let go of it? You're grinding or holding it onto it. That's how you need to hold onto this sunnah. Ya ikhwa, don't let it go. Don't let even the slightest move away from you. Hold onto it tough. وَإِيَّا أَبِنَّ وَاجِدِي وَإِيَّاكُمْ وَبِحْتَثَاتِ الْأُمُورِ. And stay away from the newly invented matters. فَإِنَّ كُلَّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ. For verily, every newly invented matter is an innovation, and every innovation is misguidance. And the narration of Sunan Nasa'i says that every misguidance will lead you to the... it will lead to the hellfire. So this hadith has told us that everybody's going to claim that they are upon the truth. Everybody's going to tell you that they are the guided people. But the Prophet didn't say to you, well, it's subjective. It's subjective. It depends on how you look at it. He didn't use those philosophical arguments. Yeah? The Prophet told us there's a concrete truth within everybody's argument. The truth still is there. And that truth is what? Holding on to the Sunnah. So which group is right is going to be seen if they're in accordance to the Sunnah. If we find Sunnahs that you don't want to implement, that you're going against, then can you claim that you're according to the Quran and the Sunnah? Huh? I'm asking you, brothers. No,